And we have Niharika Krishnan with us. She'll be talking about supply chain bots for retailers. You're up.
Thanks. Thank you for the introduction. Yes, can you also add Sridhar on live?
Sure, yeah. Thank you. And we
Yes.
also have Sridhar with us. Yeah, thank you.
Hi.
Yes. Sridhar, so we can get started. I'll just move on to the next slide.
Yeah, this is a quick intro. This is about Niharika and myself. We both work for Tata Consultancy Services, and this is our brief profile. Yeah, so this is going to be the agenda for this next 25 minutes. We will be giving a brief introduction about chatbots and how AI is playing a big role in retail these days, and the specific industry use case which we have took, that is supply chain. We will be talking about it a little bit, and then we will also talk about the tech stack that has been used for building chatbots for retailers. And then the next section would be about all the ML components that go into building these bots, right from training data, the data pre-processing, the data wrangling, the intent recognitions, and then entity recognitions, and then annotations for the training data, enabling context awareness, and how to wrap all this as a service so that it can be used by different users through different channels, and then how to retrain the models and how to encourage user feedback to improvise the bot. So that's in brief that is going to come. Yeah, Niharika, go ahead. Yeah, the first one is what are chatbots? Chatbots are artificial intelligence software, or it's a piece of code which helps a computer to understand the human interaction or a human language, so that over a period of time it can become a virtual assistant to assist the human beings in various tasks. If you see the evolution, it all started in the last few decades with scripted bots. These are nothing but rules engine. We started with rules engine, and slowly, as we developed, and Python and R came into mainstream, and then quite a few algorithms came mainstream, we went into intent recognition. So at some point, the bots were able to understand the intent of the user's question or the user's query. And then currently, we are in the phase of virtual agents where we can not only understand the intent of the question, but we can also find out the entities that were involved in that question. And we can also connect to quite a few ecosystem of enterprise applications, and we can also understand enterprise context. So currently we are in the virtual agent space, and the next phase of chatbots are going to be truly artificially exhibit truly artificial intelligence, where they can respond like human beings. They can understand the context based on the environment where they operate, and they can do self training on themselves, and then they can do self healing as well. So that is the ultimate phase of a chatbot. We are not there yet, and we are trying to get into that space. So what drives the bot market all of a sudden? There is bot phenomena everywhere. So if you see, we can see these chatbots in e-commerce sites, we can see in banking sites, we can see in mutual funds, so many sites. Wherever you go, there is a bot popping up. It's due to advances in AI and ML in the last decade or so. Democratization of cloud, computing resources were becoming available at a cheaper cost. Bot frameworks are becoming available, and deep learning is becoming mainstream. So all these are fueling the growth of bots. And if you see how to build bots, these are the top three players in the market: Amazon Lex, Google Dialogflow, and Azure Bot Services. Apart from these, there are a lot of open source frameworks. There are a lot of startups in this field. So it's a quite an interesting space to watch. Next slide. Yeah. So now coming to retail industry in particular, what is the AI market, addressable market? In 2018, it was close to 10 billion. By 2025, it is going to be 118 billion. So how and why retail is leading this pack? Because of ultra high competition among retailers for a mind share and wallet share of the customers. And then, as more and more differentiation is required to attract the customers, So bot is one way to enable that. So customer engagement, customer delight, enhance the shopping experience, advent of omni-channel, where a customer can touch base with a retailer either through an e-commerce website or through a store or through a mobile app. So many options are available today. So to enable that seamless transaction and give him a better experience, bot is going to play a vital role. And then there are quite a few business processes that can be leveraged through a bot. Some of the examples are inventory tracking, item tracking, order tracking. Next slide, please. So here is a typical supply chain where the raw material on the left hand side and then the customer is on the right hand side. In between those two, there is a empty number of steps and lots of business processes are involved to convert that raw material to a finished product and then ship that product to the distribution center and finally to a retailer aisle where the customer is going to purchase an item. If it is an online store, it can be through a web, but nevertheless, it goes all the way from raw material to the distribution center. So supply chain is a rich repository of business processes and information available in any enterprise. So supply chain is one prime area, and that is the reason why we have chosen our bot for this particular business process. And there are a lot of sub processes within supply chain, and some of the key things are listed down here. Customer engagement, customer order processing, warehouse management, store replenishment. These are all some of the key processes where the item moves, and a lot of moving parts are here. And invariably at an enterprise level, there is a hell of a lot of information available in all these sub business areas. Yeah. So now we have seen the importance of supply chain, we have seen the bots, and these are the building blocks of the bot. So the bedrock is going to be natural language processing. So natural language processing is a domain of artificial intelligence which helps computers to understand the natural language which is used for interaction between human beings, and in this case it is going to be predominantly English. Of course we have multilingual supports coming available these days. And the other building blocks are intent recognition. What is the intent of a user utterance? Is he talking about subject A? Is he talking about subject B? So those are the intent recognitions. And then you have named entity extractions. These are nothing but entities that are embedded in an intent. So I want to book a ticket to go to New Delhi. So we understood this is a travel related intent. And then the entity is about Delhi, okay? The user is wanting to go to Delhi, and that is an intent. And when he wants to go, that will be an intent, and how he wants to go there. So all these are intents, all these are entities. And then the other building block is guided conversation or conversational UI. This is more about contextual awareness. You have to handhold the conversation with the user for a period of time. The subject should be held, and it cannot be lost. Say for example, if the user is talking about travel, and then he is querying about a lot of interesting sites, interesting questions about the destination, and finally he says book a ticket, so we should be able to still hold on to the topic and understand if it's still relevant to the same destination and same intent. So that is about the conversational part in guiding the conversation. And now we have voice recognition. The utterance need not be text always. We do support voice, and then the customer can speak, and this will be converted into text and then be taken to the backend algorithms, and then we can get a response as well. And finally, we can enable multilingual support either in the form of text or in the form of voice as well. So all these put together give you a holistic chatbot solution. Next, we have the tech stack, and these are all the quite common components that have been used to build the bot. So we have Python 3x as the base, and then we have Flask, Spacy, FastText. These are some of the key packages that are used. And on the right side, you have cryptography, SMTP, Lib, JSON, and all that. So nowadays we do have a set of clients where open source technologies are gaining prominence. We do have commercial software to build upon, but the open source technologies and being in-house are being aggressively adopted these days. The prime reason being enterprise data is being protected, and quite a few retailers are not comfortable sharing their enterprise data and knowledge outside the organization. So there is some stigma there when it comes to transferring the data to cloud, knowledge to cloud. So a lot of in-house hardware is also available, and then open source technologies are leveraged widely to build these chatbots. Next slide. And here is the architecture. This is a high level architecture. On the left hand side, you can see the utterances in the form of question. And the next component is a query and response parser. That is an intelligent parser which can parse both question and a response, and then it can route it to inference engine. And the inference engine is where the intents of the utterance have been found out. And once it is found out, it hits the relevant knowledge-based models. These we call it as ML models. These are the ones which are going to give the apt answers to the user query whenever it is a fact-driven architecture. And if there are some queries which need to be hit, which need to be routed to enterprise systems to get the answers, whether, for example, do you have stock on hand for this particular item? For that, you have to reach a live application database and then get the answer back. So in those scenarios, you have to find out the entities embedded in the question and then hit the relevant web service and then reach the database and bring the answer back. So the response parser in turn processes the data and then constructs a suitable response for the user based on his access levels and then security levels, and then it routes the response to the user. Yeah, so this is about the training data. We do have domain specific data these days. Any retailer, if he needs to understand enterprise specific data, it is not a generic set of questions or generic pieces of information which you will find. So this is from where we start the actual chatbot specific subtopics, including the internals of the chatbot. I would hand over from here to Niharika, and she will take us through the remaining slides.
Right. Thank you, Sridhar. So what we see and what we've seen in the last 10 slides is, what is the general architecture? What is the chatbot all about? And how does it fit into this use case and this? So now that we've seen what the training data is, so these are the different types, right? When you have an item, you have certain metrics which you need to process. And so all these are valid questions which the user can give, and the chatbot needs to respond. So in any ML machine learning pipeline, the first thing which we basically have is first collect data, which is what we just saw. The second is to pre-process it in a way, be it using acronyms or let's say using punctuations, converting all of them to lowercase. So some of the common packages what we use are just string-based packages. But the one thing which we also need to look up is, let's say, spell checks. So it is a human practice. Let's say you make a small spelling mistake, right? But you would want the chatbot to understand that spelling mistake and correct it, and then and probably give back the right answer. So there is a an open source tool called SimSpell, which basically loads a dictionary. So what it does is it helps you to give the top or the closest recommendation. So it works on the concept of edit distance and Levenshtein distance algorithms. So what you're going to be seeing in the next few slides are all open source tools and packages which you can leverage and would work for us. So what does SimSpell do is it basically has a frequency dictionary which has the number of words and the frequency of it. So the why it kind of helps and is because, let's say, you have domain specific jargon words, some things which are not regular English dictionary words, right? So this is where the frequency dictionary, which you can create on your own corpus, helps in. So all what you can see here is a small snippet which says, in which your member spelling has been is wrong. There's an extra E over there. So what does this do is basically it gives you you know, it searches through the dictionary on the basis of edit distance, which means anything I do, whether I add a character or I delete a character, so every character is basically one operation. The cost is equal to one. So on that concept of edit distance, the verbosity is basically you can help. It will help you to list down the closest or the top or the all recommendations of that spell check, and you can get the closest one and then you know, change your user query and in such a way that your chatbot can handle that questions and not throw an error. So the second part which we saw is basically the intent recognition. What it happens is, like how Sridhar explained, it's about recognizing the purpose of a user's input, right? So you can have different types. You want a chatbot to respond to your greetings. You want a chatbot to answer what it is going to do, which is basically your metric definitions. It can also you know, fetch values from a service, a web service or a DB. So those are domain specific questions and also help you resolve your level one tickets. So any error which a user is facing and he says, I want to find a solution to this, that is, these are all different intents and the different queries which a user can throw at a chatbot. So intent recognition is basically, it helps you to, it helps you to map each query to a particular intent, and each intent will then lead to a particular action from the chatbot. So the one open source package or tool which you can kind of leverage here is FastText. So FastText is built by Facebook AI Research Labs, and they're basically a library for efficient text classification. So what you see here is, you know, a basic sample training data, the kind of training data which FastText requires. So you need to give the different intents. So those are basically your labels. And you also need to give all kinds of inputs and all kinds of which need to map to that particular intent. So all greetings, all different types need to map to the same intent. So once you do that, using FastText is pretty easy. It's basically a supervised learning which you can leverage, and you can give your file name as your input. You can tune your hyperparameters based on your epoch, based on the n-grams, based on your learning rate. And then, so what this really outputs is you save your model and you load your model and you send your input text. So what this helps is it gives you the greeting. And once you have the greeting, you can then customize your FastText, or you can customize your chatbot to handle those labels and those intents, right? So this is how you get started with FastText. And once we have our intent in place, we then move on to actually extracting entities from them. So some of them, let's say a metric definition, don't need to, you know, you just have a pointed question and a pointed answer. But what if you need to extract certain entities, be it a supplier's name or be it a certain metric like units, dollars, or percentages? So this is the whole concept where named entity recognition comes into picture. So what you see on the right here is, so Spacy is, again, an open source tool or a package which will help you to extract these named entities. But what it does is it has pre-trained models which will help you to extract these. It can help you to extract person, organization, countries, you know, date, time, percentage, all of them have been built. But again, since we are talking specifically about chatbot for retailers, what you can do is you can basically build your own custom model, which will help you to where you can give your own training data and, you know, create training data in such a way that you can give the positional indexes of these entities. So what you see here is the kind of input data which is required by Spacy specifically. So you enter all your statements and you give your positional indexes of these. So if you want to extract shirt, the position of shirt is basically from 21st character to 26th character. And the entity here is your product name. So after you give, let's say, thousands and thousands of input like this, you basically train your NER model using Spacy open source tool. And you can help it extract those particular things so that you can use those values as your metrics to fetch web queries fetch from your web services. So when you have certain item number or a DC and you want to fetch value from that, this is what you have to do. So this whole thing has been basically annotated and automated so that the complete training data to the annotation of this and finally splitting it into your training, validation, and test, and then loading your model for prediction. So now that we have our training data ready, so this is just a brief overview of how Spacy works, right? So you have your different labels. You need to give your gradient. You have to give your epoch. learning rate and all of that, and you basically train your model in such a way that those entities are extracted. So the next part, now that we have our intent and entities extracted, now that we know our chatbot is able to extract relevant information from the query which the user has entered, we come to the fact which is basically context awareness. So for example, if there's a situation where I ask you, okay, who's the president of India, and the next the user is asking that what is his term or how long it is. So the chatbot has to understand that we are talking about the president of India. So to understand and to retain the metrics, to retain the user queries and the entities is where we bring in the whole context awareness. One way you can leverage this is using Flask sessions. So they're basically key value pairs where you have session variables and values, where you can use your session ID as your key where, and map all of your session data and user input based on that. So it's basically a slot-based logic where through which you can check the mandatory entities. You can respond back to the user if certain entities for your question is not fulfilled. And this context is basically there till your user logs out of the application, right? So we come to the last stage of our entire thing. Now that your machine learning model is ready, your query is done, you have your intent NER in place, and you also have your context awareness in place. Now we come to the part where you deploy and basically expose your chatbot as a web service. This is where you can leverage Flask. So it basically interacts with your UI, your Angular React UI, and then so you have a JSON-based request and a response, and this will help you to get the input from the user, hit the relevant web services from where you can extract your information, and maintain your session, maintain context awareness, and then give the response back to the user. So the last part is, so every solution always has a scope for improvement. So what you can, what we've also done is basically have a user feedback, which is at different levels. You can have a reply, every reply level comes up, thumbs down feedback at every user level and the whole solution level feedback. So this basically helps us understand which were right, which were wrong, understand the user requirements, the business requirements, and this leads us to better enhancing our chatbot model. You can do it, so there are prediction accuracies based on whether your intents are right, based on your NER models. So this will kind of help us lead to the model retraining. So you can choose whether you want to increase data, you want to bring in new intents, you want to bring in new entities, you want to do some hyperparameter tuning, and improve your model as and when the business requirement involve and as and when the users use your chatbot. So we come to the last part, and Sridhar, if you would like to take over the conclusion.
Yeah. So now we saw all the building blocks, how we can build a bot. And if you want to replicate, here are certain tips. The first and foremost, leverage NLP and Python. And then you need to integrate with your own enterprise supply chain systems, the ecosystem of supply chain applications. And then that is very much required because the information is available in lot of databases and relevant tables there. And then one can leverage a lot of pre-trained ML classifiers, be it a traditional classifier or a deep learning model. And it could be in the form of a TensorFlow or a PyTorch model. Nowadays, we do have a lot of transformer-based classifiers for a high level of accuracy, especially when it comes to text processing and context awareness. And then The prime purpose of a bot, in addition to all these application systems like reporting systems, dashboards, weekly reports, monthly reports, so many transaction systems that come embedded with the reporting application. So the user is able to get to those information, but it takes a hell of a lot of time and sift through to reach a piece of information. So the prime use of bot will be support a pointed question and get a pointed answer. So the sooner we are able to get there and seamlessly we are able to get there, that will determine the success of the bot. And then enable capability for the model to relearn from its mistakes so that it continuously improves. That is what Niharika spoke about in the previous slide about model retraining and the reasons for a model going stale. And then finally, it has to exhibit context awareness, and it has to handhold the pieces of information in its memory as long as the customer is staying put to a particular subject or a domain. It cannot drop the ball abruptly. And then finally, in this digital world, everybody is using mouse extensively and enabled a hell of a lot of clicks to reach to the information that they need. So other prime objective of the bot should be to remove those number of clicks and seamlessly reach to the piece of information that a user is looking for. So if you can build a bot that exhibits these things, and the success of that implementation is quite bright. So with that, we will stop our presentation, and we are open for questions.
Hey, thank you, Niharika and Sridhar. That was a wonderful presentation. And yeah. I certainly learned a couple of things about chatbots, about intents, slots, and a whole lot about that. So I do have a couple of questions for you. So in the conclusion, you touched about you know, how transformer models can be used in NLP. So I see that, you know, of late there are quite a few of them coming up, be it BERT, XLNet, or many more about, you know, localization of text. So what are your thoughts among all of these models?
Yeah, see, these transformer models are all very complicated neural network architectures, and they come with millions of weights and biases. So there will always be a technical challenge, and the common example would be BERT, Google's BERT. And apart from the transformer, under the transformer category, we have a lot of variations of BERT, like Albert, Dilbert, sorry, Distilbert, and so many variations of BERT, different improvements. So all these will help to improve the context of the contextual mechanism with which BERT can correlate different entities or different parts of the intent, and it can seamlessly understand. So it is, as a human being, one can understand with the examples what Niharika or I stated in a piece of conversation, but for a software to understand, that is where these attention mechanisms and all these are coming. And this will certainly aid in improving the contextual capability of the bots. Yes, but it comes with the cost. You need the relevant hardware to run all those transformers and to realize their potential.
Yeah, and I think attention algorithms are another area where I think the NLP community is building a lot.
Yes, so. Yes, you're right.
So we do have a couple of more questions. Let me move on to them. Do you recommend any open source parsers, or which has, you know, which has custom built parsing specific to each domain?
Yeah, the parsers which we have built for retail domain are all custom, because we don't have any generic questions like a travel app or a pizza ordering app, like where the subject is quite restricted. But when you get into a retailer's enterprise, there are a lot of jargons, technical jargons, a lot of acronyms, and there are a lot of company-specific terminology which are extensively used to communicate. So predominantly, we use custom-built parsers, which a predefined or readily available parser may not be able to support that. So that has been our experience.
So just to add on to that, just one thing. So in the slide, I must have probably showed you a few training data examples, right, where you had available to ship, recommended shipments. You have certain very specific suppliers, DCs. So these are all, like I said, not part of your regular dictionary words, or let's say supplier name and all of that. So an open source, let's say a custom built parser, like Sridhar said, you know, helps us to get what the user wants. So it's a very specific chatbot, not something which all retailers can leverage throughout, right?
Right. So SME help is like essential.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
So moving on to the next one, we have, from where do we get domain-specific data for training?
So I think you kind of answered this question, isn't it, Sridhar? So you need SME help. So
So that's a billion-dollar question. For any machine learning use case, this is always a billion-dollar question. So nobody gives you data. So if you are implementing for a particular client, be it a retailer or a banking customer or anyone, a travel customer, so you have to rely on the enterprise data. That is where tons of data is available. And that is also where it comes with more scrutiny. They are not ready to part away with this data so that you can take it to cloud and do something. So this is where their enterprise knowledge is available. So it has to be the enterprise data. There is no enterprise data available open source for anyone to play around with. Yeah.
What you can do is, one thing what you can do is the initial training data slide which we had. So you don't get thousands and thousands of data from the client or whoever it is. You only get certain specific questions. So let's say 15, 20 varieties of questions. So what you can do is you can leverage Python and kind of augment that and make variations and build your own automated Python script, which is what was done. And you can make that as big as, let's say, so that it can actually have an impact in your machine learning models, right? So that's how you can kind of explore what you have.
Yeah, moving on to the next one. We actually have a whole line of questions. Let me just pick, one or two from them.
Okay.
Next one is, how will the feedback be used to improve model performance? I think this is a very important one because, to build your model, you need to be able to capture feedback. So could you guys shed any light on these?
Yeah. Niharika, shall I go ahead with this?
Yes.
Yeah. We can enable feedback, either at the individual response level for the bot, or we can at the entire session level, how the user interaction with the bot happens. So the two levels you can enable feedback. Mm-hmm. And once you get that feedback, you can put it in a Splunk dashboard and then you can drill down and then come up with various metrics to show what sort of questions were getting thumbs up, what were getting thumbs down, and how frequently, and all sorts of analysis we can do. So with this information, now the onus is on the machine learning team or the data science team to revisit the model and see what aspects of the model can be tweaked further so that the bot response is highly appreciated. So it is it enables a feedback loop to revisit your model and fix the certain aspects of the entire pipeline where you can improvise on the response. So it is a continuous process. It is not a one-time work till the model stabilizes. Yeah.
Thank you. So let me move on to the last one. So this one's again quite an important one. So in production, what is the strategy for the do we use Pickling or do we use any other tools for storing the models?
Yeah. See, as we get into a deep learning world with all transformer models and all that, Pickling is no more in the picture. Pickling is all for smaller sized models. When we talk about gigabyte sized models, there is always a challenge. So the productionizing currently models are not generally published to Git, only your code gets published to Git. So for the models, you should have a separate repository other than Git from where you can move. Or there are instances where certain clients enable the model build in production itself. So those are the two strategies available as of now, especially when the model sizes are big. But when the models are small, certainly Pickling can be done. And then it can go as part of your regular CI/CD pipeline. But when the model sizes are big, your CI/CD pipeline doesn't work, especially for the model deployment.
So thanks a lot, Niharika and Sridhar again. It was a wonderful talk and quite insightful.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks to the PyCon India team.